Welcome to Designing Hardware. I'm Fox, aka the coreWeaver, and this is going to be a series about the LC meter I built. If you're involved in electronics in any kind of way, you should have one of these, and if you don't, you can build one yourself. This one here is very accurate, very useful, and it's also pretty easy to build. I'm going to try and give you every little bit of information about the LC meter, so it shouldn't be too difficult to understand the theory behind it and also to be able to build one, even if you're a beginner in electronic design. You should be able to finish this project in 2 or 3 days, maybe a whole weekend. It all comes down to soldering the parts, printing the case, and then assembling everything. You will need a soldering iron. You don't need an expensive soldering station for this. You're not going to solder any SMD components. Some solder wick. An extraction pump could be useful, tweezers, pliers, some isopropyl alcohol to clean the board. You're going to need a PCB and obviously the components which you're going to need to solder, the PCB Gerber files along with all the other files that you're going to need for this project are available on the GitHub repository I created for this project. You can also get a copy of the PCB from me. I'm going to do a giveaway after this series. I'll tell you more about that in a second. You're also going to need a programmer for AVR microcontrollers. The LC meter doesn't have an ISP connector, so you'll have to find an adapter or another board where you can insert the MCU and flash the firmware. If you have access to a 3D printer and you also want to build the case in the exact same way I did, you're going to need 3 different filament colors. I printed mine using PLA, but it really doesn't matter what kind of filament you're using. We're going to need some glue to assemble the case, a set of files, sandpaper, and a deburrer. Not entirely necessary, but very nice to have one, very useful. The total cost for this project, somewhere between 25 and 30 bucks. And this includes the cost of the filament for the 3D printer. This series has 4 parts. The first part is going to deal with the operation principle, and I'm also going to explain how I wrote the algorithm on which the whole software is based. In part 2, we're going to get into details. We're going to take a look at the schematic and the PCB. Then I'm going to solder everything on the PCB, and I'm also going to show you the software for the microcontroller. Part 3 is going to be about the case, how I 3D modeled everything, and then we're going to start assembling everything. And finally, the last part, we're going to put the LC meter to work. I'm going to test it under different conditions. Hopefully this will give you a clearer picture how useful this tool is, and also hopefully it will motivate some of you to try and build one. Everything about this project is open source, both the hardware and the software. I'm giving you guys all the information and all my files, everything you need to build this. There will be a link in the description pointing to a repository, and there you'll find the schematic, the PCB, a bill of materials, also the Gerber files for the PCB, the firmware for the microcontroller, including the source files, the PC application, and all the STL files to 3D print the parts for the case. If you're new to this channel, leave a comment, tell me what would you like me to build next. And if you like this series, please make sure to smash that like button, and I will continue to crank up these videos. Like I said earlier, I'm giving away 3 copies of the PCB. Just leave a comment, and 1 month after I uploaded the last part, I will pick the winners and send them a message. And with that being said, let's get this on. Alright, so before we dive into the workflow of the designing process, let me go ahead and clear some of the basic questions for the beginners. First, what is an LC meter? What does it do? And second, what are the most common situations where you're going to use it? In electronics, we use the letter L for inductances and the letter C for capacitances. Basically, an LC meter is a device that measures both inductances or capacitances, depending which mode you're in. This is a standard situation where I use my LC meter. I need to determine what's inside these bags. I mean, I know these are inductors. The labels have become unreadable. And I bought this 2 or 3 years ago, not more than 3 years ago. And just look at this, this one too. I mean, this is what happens when electronic distributors try to save money by using cheap ink ribbons for their label makers. And this happens a lot. What do? You take them out, measure them, and then make a new label. This is one of those times when having an LC meter comes in handy. Another scenario, when you try to recover components from boards and you don't have the schematic for these boards, you could try to read the values of the components by reading the markings on the components or color-coded rings. It's still a better idea to desolder them and then measure them, because when you do so, you're also making sure that they still work. Now, for me, perhaps the most important reason to own an LC meter is whenever I select the right parts, whenever I try to find the right parts for critical sections of a board. And what I mean by critical is when you're doing RF design or oscillators or antenna matching circuits, choosing the right components is very, very important. Usually the process of fine-tuning this kind of circuits involves an oscilloscope and sometimes other very expensive equipment. But the first thing I do, I always measure these parts. Make sure you're using small tolerance parts and measure their values before you start soldering. I'm going to give you an example here. Let's say I want to build a Colpitts oscillator. And I'm going to draw a small schematic here. This intro is longer than I intended. But I just wanted to make sure that even those who are beginners in electronics will understand what I'm talking about here. So anyway, this is our Colpitts oscillator, and basically this circuit outputs a signal with a specific frequency. So the frequency of the output signal, we're going to calculate this with this formula, where CT equals, is basically the series capacitance of these two capacitors here, C1 and C2. And I have a tool to calculate this frequency or the values of the capacitors and the inductor to get a specific frequency. Let me go back to my computer. This is a tool that I wrote in Delphi a few years ago, and what it does is, based on this formula right here, it calculates one of these values if I know two of these values. So I can either start with calculate the output frequency knowing the capacitors and the inductor, or calculate the capacitance knowing the frequency and the inductance, or I know the frequency and the capacitors and I want to calculate the value of the inductor. Now I'm going to use this to show you the huge difference between working with components that you measure before or just reading their markings and trusting they're around those values. Let's start with a frequency of 328 kilohertz. I'm using this value on purpose here. I'm going to show you why in a second. And a 10 micro Henry inductor. If I click calculate, it will show me that C1 and C2 will have to be very close to 47 nanofarads. I'm looking for a bag with a label 47 nanofarads. I take two of these capacitors out, solder them, and I can almost guarantee you this frequency here will be way off, will be nowhere around this value of 328 kilohertz. Why is that? Well, because you have to take tolerances into account. These capacitors here that I'm taking out from a bag labeled 47 nanofarads could be 5% or 10% or 20% tolerance. So if they're 20% tolerance, 20% from 47 nanofarads is more than 9.5 nanofarads. So that means they could be as low as 38 nanofarads and as high as 56, somewhere between 38 and 56. Let's see what happens if I use two 38 nanofarad capacitors and my inductor remains 10 microhenries. I will get 365 kilohertz, and this is almost 40 kilohertz more than what I tried to achieve. This is why it's such a great idea to measure the components before you are soldering them. If you have an LC meter, you are measuring every component before you solder it. This way, you make sure that they are 47 nanofarads. Let's say you find two of them around 47 nanofarads. The closest this value gets to 47 nanofarads, the closer you get to the desired frequency right here. You see? Somewhere in the mid-90s, a guy called Neil Hecht came up with the idea of measuring inductors and capacitors by using an oscillating circuit and a microcontroller. He made his design open source, and I would like to thank him for that. A lot of the LC meters today still use the same principle. I designed and calculated by myself pretty much everything in this project, the schematic, the PCB. I wrote the firmware for the controller from scratch, but I don't want to take credit for the idea, which belongs to Neil. He should be the one who gets the credit for it. Sadly, I heard he passed away a while ago, but I still hope he can hear me. Maybe he's sitting on an ice cloud somewhere and watches the video. Thanks, Neil. So let's go ahead and see how everything works. The building blocks of the project. So we have this oscillator here and the microcontroller. The oscillator will output a signal with a specific frequency, and we're going to measure the frequency using the microcontroller. By the way, I'm using a dedicated chip for this, but to make it easier to understand, I'm only drawing the tank circuit, the inductor capacitor oscillator here. And what we want to do next is, let's add the components that we want to measure to this block schematic. We want to be able to add the inductor that we want to determine, LDET, in series to this existing inductor. And we also want to be able to add the capacitance that we want to measure, that we want to determine in parallel to this capacitor. And to do that, we're using a double relay. Let's name it Relay 1. We're using the microcontroller to drive it. So this relay is acting like a double switch. And we also want to be able to connect yet another capacitance, a very precise capacitor, to calibrate the whole system. And we're going to use a second relay to connect or disconnect this calibration capacitance in parallel to our existing C. And we're also going to drive this second relay using the microcontroller, which is going to be an 8-bit AVR. The rest is just auxiliary parts, some push buttons. Some LEDs and an LCD, which we're going to use to display the measured values. So this oscillator here will output a signal, and first we'll use the AVR to measure this frequency. Now there is a little bit of math involved here, some basic equations, but don't worry, I'll walk you through it. So we can write the first equation, which involves the frequency we just measured, f equals 1 over 2 pi square root from LC. And we're going to name this equation 1, and we're going to name this frequency F1. Next, we want to switch relay 2 and add the calibration capacitor, and this will basically change the output frequency. And we can write F2 equals 1 over 2 pi square root from L multiplied with the parallel capacitance C plus C cal, and we're naming this equation number 2. After that, we disconnect C-cal, and now we're going to have two scenarios. Depending what we want to measure, capacitance or inductance, we switch relay 1. First, let's add C-det, and we measure the frequency again. We can write F3 equals 1 over 2 pi square root from L multiplied with C plus C to determine equation number 3. This is the equivalent capacitance of the two capacitors in parallel. If we want to measure an inductance, we switch relay 1 to add L to determine in series to L, and we can write F4 equals 1 over 2 pi square root from L plus L to determine multiplied with C, equation number 4.
The last two equations that I'm going to give you are the ones that we are actually going to use to calculate the inductance and the capacitance that we want to measure. First, for the capacitance, C to determine equals F1 over F3 square minus 1 over F1 over F2 square minus 1 multiplied with C cal equation number 5. And for the inductance, L to determine F1 over F4 square minus 1 multiplied with F1 over F2 square minus 1 multiplied with 1 over C cal multiplied with 1 over 2 pi F1 square equation number 6.
And now let's go ahead and demonstrate these two equations 5 and 6. Now that we prove that these two equations here are correct, all that we need in order to calculate the value of an inductor or a capacitor which we measure is the value for this calibration capacitor right here and the values for these frequencies which are measured in different instances. And now let's go ahead and write all this into an algorithm. These are the steps that I want to implement in software. Each time we power up the system, or whenever we do a reset, we want to disconnect any additional inductance or capacitance from the oscillating circuit. So for that, both relays must be off. Next, we measure the frequency of the oscillating circuit. Step 3. We switch on relay 2, which will connect the calibration capacitor to the oscillating circuit, and then we measure the frequency again. Then we switch relay 2 off. Now we're going to have the two different scenarios we were talking about. If we're in the inductance measuring mode, we switch relay 1 so that the inductance that we want to measure gets connected in series to the oscillating circuit. Step 5, measure the frequency again. Step 6, we use equation 6 to calculate the inductance and we display the value on the LCD. And if we do a capacitance measurement, we do all the same steps, the difference being relay 1 will connect the capacitance that we want to measure in parallel with the oscillator's capacitor, and we use equation number 5 to determine the capacitance. We're going to use the push buttons to switch between these modes. And we also can say that these first three steps are the calibration steps, and we can re-enter calibration whenever we press both keys at the same time. And we'll use the LEDs to signal which operating mode is currently selected.